And there we are. Hey everybody, what do you think of this? As you all know, I don't do any work up front, so I don't know what to expect. I know, even though there's no sign on the dial, it's a Vulcan, like the Vulcan cricket. And this might be an interesting movement to look at. And you can see it's silver, so the black, that is the oxide. So with a good polish, there will be a dramatic change in this watch. I presume it's a trench watch around late 1910 until the mid 20s, I think. And this is the name of the owner, and it's the grandfather of the owner at this moment, who I'm going to restore it for. If I lift the crystal, you can see the changing color. So, because of the discoloration, you see the yellowish green. This material is organic. And it's celluloid, same as in the film, in the strips. Extremely flammable, and with the downside, the discoloration due to UV radiation. So if you see the discoloration in a plexiglass, then you know it is not plastic, but it's organic celluloid. But I want to tell you about the hand coming off, especially this sub-second. The hand is so light, it doesn't come off the pivot by itself, hardly ever. Usually the dial lifts up and then pushes the hand from the pivot. So not just the hand coming off, but it's being pushed by the dial being loose, usually. Well, that works. So now I would like to take off the hands with the Presto tool. Well, there's the Vulcan. Pivots are okay from the balance wheel. Well, what do we see? 15 joules for a watch from at least 100 years old. Pretty good. Of course, not Inca block, because it's pre-1948. And this is strange. I don't see any dial feet there and there. So there is something happening with the dial. And we know that even before we remove the dial. And there's a lot of rust here. I expected a blue balance spring. So that is something to remember if maybe in the last 100 years the balance spring has been replaced, but I'm not sure. There's work to be done. I'm looking at this. For people who are not familiar, it is wobbly. And Narcissus well spotted. For people not familiar for watches, the red dots there, there, and there are rubies. A very hard material, and that's an... those are rubies, and those are bearings. And here is no bearing. It traveled far. And then you can see that the steel pivot has eaten away of the brass bridge. So there's work to be done. And if there's play like this, you can see that the gear is very wide. It's the same as a mast from a ship. If a ship goes a bit like this, the mast will move like that. Same here, if there's just a bit of play in the pivot, then the whole wheel will move like that. And then it can touch this part here, the ratchet wheel, or underneath here, underneath the bridge. So we have to address that. But there is an important question. If there are no dial feet here, how is the dial secured? These screws were would have black polish. If you clean them and make the slot straight again, it would look so nice. Look at this. A slight rust. That's too much. And now I would like to take out the movement out of the case and try to remove the dial. But because there are no dial feet visible, then it might be glued to the movement, so we have to be very careful with that. The spring on this side, it's underneath the click, so I will take it out anyway. I would like to gently pry it up, but I don't want to make scratches. As usual, by these case screws, we can see if the movement comes out from the back or from the front. Now you can see the case screws here on top of this ridge, so that prevents it the movement to go via the front. So this is a front loader. So from the dial side, it comes out. Oh. And now you can see the rust better. Now I use the tiniest of my screwdrivers, so not to bend the dial. I've got a scalpel, razor sharp, and then I can go underneath, because if there are no dial feet, it has to be glued or something. Yeah, the dial feet were removed. You can see here the adhesive. Those are removed. And I love this old enamel. You can see the air bubbles in the glass. Well, again, you can see the old blue. You can see the fingerprints from a previous watchmaker. And here, where the glue was. Very unusual setting lever spring. Do you see that? Usually it's a huge plate. And now it's really elaborate. And the yoke, which is usually quite simple, has this here. It is interesting. Now here the cannon pinion, and there's quite some rust. But that might be rust from the hands, but we'll see. Why I say this is interesting, because you see this plate is curved here, the setting lever. And famous drawing. Again, with every remark I make, there are dozens of exceptions, but usually quite common. This piece is milled out, so it used to be a plate like this, and this material has been removed, and then you got a curved plate. From America, the movements, they made it like this. They just bent the plate, and that's what the setting lever is in this movement. Usually, the Swiss milled out this material. And usually, I know there's loads of exceptions. This is the American or Japanese way of making things. And I hope you can see here the curved angle from this part over here. You see it's curved. Remove the setting lever spring, and just to relax Harry Otter, I will remove the yoke spring straight away. Very heavy spring. You can see how high it is. It got loads of tension. And here you can see the bend. Well, first remove the balance wheel. Well, because of the age of the movement, even though it's probably a new hairspring, balance spring, I'd like to lift not only the balance cock, this bit, but the balance itself as well. So I'm going to lift it here underneath with an oiler. One and two. Not to strain the very delicate pelage. That's nice. And here you can see the slot going underneath the bridge. So you can lift it up gently. 2.4. Well, as spelled forks go, you can do better than that. Over here, banking pins. You can see some residue on the jewel for the pallet fork. A lot of residue. Well, these are not lubricated, so if it's oil, it's a mistake by a less experienced watchmaker. It might be moisture. Let's have a look with some peg wood, if I can remove it. And this is interesting. You can see the jewel isn't pressed fit, but it's well encapsulated. If it's press fit, that's a cylindrical jewel, and that's just pressed in and it fits. And this one, there was some slither of material left open. Then you put in the jewel, and then you rub the material back together. And you can see here the overlap of material here. There's a slight overlap. And then you can see it's a bit encapsulated in place instead of the press fit. I would like to check again if there's not too much play in the pivots like this. And I simply move the barrel back and forth. And then the rotation of the gear train reverses. And then you can see if there's a play. I'm doing like an end-to-end test from barrel, center wheel, third wheel, second wheel, and escape wheel. And see how it moves. That's why I... You see, with some peg wood, so I don't make any scratches, I go back and forth on the main barrel. And then the whole gear train is being reversed. And if you look especially there, you can see there loads of play. And there, and this is slightly worrying, and that is the well turning point of the gears. And these are rubies, which is very hard material, and the inside, the pivot itself, is hardened steel. The rubies are a harder material. It's got a hardness 9, and the steel is hardness 7, 7.5. So the steel will wear quicker than the ruby. So the pivot will wear more easily. And worst case scenario, that's a normal pivot from steel. And if it's worn, it will look a bit like this, because here the material is eaten away. So if a pivot can move like that in the ruby, in the bearing, there is a good possibility that the pivots are worn. And we're in that stage now, still. To see what the wear and tear is in this particular movement. Well, the center wheel has got huge play, and the third wheel has got huge play. So there is a chance that this pivot is mushroom shaped. And if it isn't, then maybe this ruby is cracked or worn, and then we replace the ruby. 25 to 30 individual parts that you see now. The stud, the pin in the stud, the spring, balance wheel, all the screws. But they all have got the same function. So if you test the balance wheel, just put it in the movement and just move it like that, you're testing about 30 parts at the same time. Is it moving freely? Has it got a wobble? Are the pivots not broken or bent? So we test the parts as function groups. So balance wheel is a function group. The gear train is a function group. These are all individual parts, but do the same. So we test in function groups. And then, it's easily to see where a fault is, at least in each function group. And then you can deduct where the malfunction is. And then you can zoom in that particular function group to see where the exact malfunction is. A ruby only got two sizes, the exterior diameter and the interior diameter. So we got, things like this, and well, maybe I can show you. These are all rubies, and here you can see the different shapes and the inner diameter and the outer diameter. And then we can measure the original one, and then we can see if we can find a perfect fit. And because there are many, many manufacturers of rubies, then we have two more assortments. So if in all these tubes there must be the correct one, but you have to find them. It's interesting that the hook is bent. Do you see that? This is interesting. And it caught my eye because this has got a different color than the rest of the spring. And this is a clockmaker way for repairing. A clockmaker solution for a watchmaking problem. This spring has been broken. Exactly, just thought Steve. Exactly. Once this spring was broken, and you can see there's not too much spring in the barrel. It looks a bit empty. So a bit was broken, they removed it, then exactly what just old Steve said, they glowed out the end, and then because it's carbon steel, if you just, oh thank you so much Per, oh that's so nice, thank you so much for the bits. Cool. This is carbon steel, and for springs, and that that breaks very easily. But if you heat it until orange red, it glows up. Then it's de-stressed, and then you can bend the end bit like this. In modern terms, with so much well, so easily we can find parts, you say, why not replace the spring? So with a modern head-on, we think it's a botch job, like a quick fix. But then again, it's an antique movement, 100 years old. Maybe in the 30s, 40s, there wasn't a supply of parts. And then this is a solution just to make the watch working again with less power reserve, simply because the spring is a bit shorter. But yeah, why not? So I don't want to judge too harsh on previous watchmakers, because I firmly believe everybody is doing their best. And this is probably the best they could at the time. So it's a very short spring. So we have to replace it anyway, because there's really no tension at all left. The final bit. Let's see the condition of the pivots, because that is really important. It seems there's a lot of... I would like to have a look at this pinion in greater detail. There's a hair in there. Do you see it? Not too bad. And then this one. I can't take out the second wheel because of the elongated pivot for the sub-second. Ooh, look at that pinion, or the pivot. Somebody was really having fun polishing the pivot. Het verschil. Wow. It's thin, but it's conical as well. So, had to make a huge difference if it face down or face up, because if this wheel lowers, the diameter becomes bigger. We have to work on that wheel a lot. That was the one when we saw this, so we found the problem. All the wheels are very sticky coming out of the main plate. Now that's rust. We really have to clean these wheels. That really shows the age.
So the VH lost contact.
And then my rookie mistake. I forgot to remove the cannon pinion first. Oh, could be worse. But then again, these pivots were rotating not in a jewel, but in very soft brass. So it's not really strange that the pivots look okay, but that the holes are worn. There it is. It's a very long time since this capstone has seen some lubrication, completely dry. That's it for me. Thank you so much for watching. We do the stream once a week, every Tuesday, 8:30. But we're going to do some more in between streams and maybe on several platforms. So maybe Facebook and YouTube. But nothing is going to change for this Twitch Tuesday evenings. All stays the same, no problem. Again, thank you so much for watching. Hope to see you next week. If you follow the stream, you get a notification every time we go online. Enjoy your evening and hope to see you next week. I see you. Bye-bye.